This is direct instruction for August 14th, 2016. And we're going to go through some of the review sections. This is Chapter R for review. So some of this may be brand new to you. Some may be review. We won't cover every topic because we just don't have time. The first hour and a half will be devoted to direct instruction. And then always the last half hour, I'll stop the recording, and then I'll answer any questions you have. Because the questions you have, you may not want put out there on the internet. And so this first part will be the YouTube video. Okay. Section R.1, sets in the real number line. And these are the different competencies. And like I said, we're skipping over some of these, and we'll go down to evaluate exponential expressions, square roots, and cube roots. Now for our exponents. If we have 2, and then we have a number that's up here, it's smaller, and it's a sub or a superscript, I should say. This is called our exponent. It's also called our power. And this is read as 2 to the 4th power. Now what that means is we're going to take 2 and multiply it times itself 4 times. The exponent tells us how many of these we have. So 4. If we had 2 to the 6th power, then we'd have 6 2's. And 2 times 2 is 4, times another 2 is 8, times another 2 is 16. So 2 to the 4th will give us 16. Now on your calculator, you have to come up here. And I'll be going over the TI-3, TI-84 models specifically. If you got a different model, it's probably not going to be much help. You can contact me, and I may have other resources you can use for those. But 2 to the 4th. I do 2. And how you do an exponent on your calculator is this button right here. You can see it turn red when I click it. That's the caret. And then I do 4, and then press enter. And I'll give it 16. Now for exponents. Now for exponents, the exponent only affects what is to its immediate left unless there is parentheses. Then it affects everything inside the parentheses. So for exponents, the exponent only affects what's to its immediate left unless there's parentheses, and affects everything inside the parentheses. What I mean by that is if I have these two examples, now what's to the left of this exponent, this power, is a set of parentheses. So that fourth power affects everything inside the parentheses. So this is going to be negative 2 times negative 2 times negative 2 times negative 2. Negative 2 times negative 2 is 4, times another negative 2 is negative 8, times another negative 2 is positive 16. On the other hand, this one, what's to its immediate left, is just the 2, not the negative. So that negative does not get affected by the exponent. So this is the negative carries down, and then we got 4 2's. And this problem will give us a negative 16. So that's the difference between those two. And there we are. We have square roots now. Now, square root looks like this. So that symbol you see right there is a square root, and that's the square root of 16. What we do is, with the 16, we rewrite it as 4 times 4. And with square roots, we're looking for a pair of somethings. Now, here's a pair of 4s. So a pair of 4s is going to come out in front as a single 2, or single 4. Sorry, I was thinking my next example is going to do. Okay, so we're looking for a pair of somethings, and a pair comes out as a single one of them. Now let's say I had something that didn't work out perfectly like that. Square root of negative, or square root of 12. If I can see the prime factorization of it, I go ahead and write it. 12 is 2 times 2 times 3. But if I can't see it, then you can do the tree breakdown. And remembering your primes are 2, 3, 5, 7, 11. Probably 95% of the problems in college algebra revolve around those five primes. There's an infinite number of primes, but those are the ones you see the most. So I start my first prime, 2, and I ask if 12 is divisible by 2, and it is, 2 times 6. 2's prime, so I circle it. And 6, I'm still on my first prime, which is 2, is divisible by 2, 2 times 3. 2's prime, so I circle it, and 3's prime, so I circle it. When all of your numbers are circled and you can't break it down anymore, that's your prime factorization. Now remember, we're looking for a pair of somethings. Here's a pair of 2's. So this pair of 2's is going to come out in front as a single 2. And the 3 remains inside the square root because we need a pair of them. We only got one 3. So that'd be our answer. Now these are called square roots. If you have something called cube roots, that was where you have a 3 inside this slot right here. This slot is called your index. If you do not have a number like these over here, your index is by default 2. And that tells you how many of them are you looking for. Your index is 2, that means you're looking for a pair of something, 2 of them. If your index is 3, you're looking for 3 of whatever. For example, 8 is 2 times 2 times 2. Our index is 3, so we're looking for a set of 3 of something. Well, here's 3 2's, so 3 2's is going to come out in front as a single 2. And when I take those out, there's nothing left inside the radical, so the radical disappears. And our answer is 2. Now this applies not just to numbers, but x's or whatever you're working with. For example, if I had, 16x to the 4th. Well, index is 3, we got a cube root. 16 is 4 2's. X to the 4th is 4 x's. Now our index is 3, which means looking for a set of 3 of something. Here's 3 2's, so 3 2's is going to come out in front as a single 2. And these three X's will come out in front as a single X. So we're going to have a 2, we'll have an X, and then we've got our cube root, and we're left with one 2 inside, and we're left with one X inside. And that would be our answer. Now you can have other numbers in there. Specifically, what we have here just says square roots and cube roots, but you could have a 4, a 5, 6, whatever in there. And if I had, say, 48. If I did my tree breakdown, 48 is divisible by 2, 2 times 24. 2 is prime, so I circle it. 24 is 2 times 12. 2 is prime, so I circle it. 12 is 2 times 6. 2 is prime, so I circle it. And 6 is 2 times 3. 2 is prime, so I circle it, and 3 is prime, so I circle it. So it looks like I have 4 2's and 1 3. Now our index here is a 4. This is the 4th root is how you read that. 4th root of 48. You could say this one's the 3rd root of 16x to the 4th or cube root. And I don't think I ever heard anybody say call this a second root, but I mean, technically it is, or it's a square root. But anyway, our index is 4, which means looking for a set of 4 of something. Here's 4 2s, so 4 2s is going to come out in front as a single 2. And the 3 remains inside because we need 4 of them to bring it out, because our index is 4. So that would give us our answer. Now the 6th competency in this section R.1 is apply the order of operations. So let's talk about that. Order of operations. Please excuse my dear Aunt Sally. These are ways to remember, mnemonic, ways to remember what do you do when you're working a problem in terms of your order of operations. Order of operations is tells you what do you do first. You're baking pizza, frozen pizza. They give you the steps. Preheat oven, put your pizza on a cookie sheet or on an oven rack, set your timer, you know, they give you all the steps. But if you run across a problem in mathematics, how do you know what to do first? The first letter of each one of these indicates an operation, or possibly more than one. For example, the P. That's parentheses, but it also stands for brackets, and also stands for absolute value. Absolute value is a little bit different, but some kind of grouping. Now, what that means is to do whatever is inside of these items. It does not necessarily mean get rid of the parentheses. It may happen, but it doesn't mean get rid of them. It means do whatever's inside the parentheses. In case of the absolute value, it also goes a step further and means get rid of the absolute value. But parentheses and brackets, it does not necessarily mean that. Now, excuse. This is exponents. So you do exponents next. And my dear, MD, this is multiply or divide as you encounter either one from left to right. And AS, Aunt Sally, add or subtract as you encounter either one from left to right. So when you run across a problem and you're trying to figure out what do I do first, specifically, we're going to be dealing with numbers, but we're going to see that the order of operations also extends over to variables. Although it's not absolute, there'll be times where we ignore the order of operations and we go with a step-by-step approach on solving a math problem. Okay. Now let's take a look at an example. Let me see, 3 and then 4 minus 2 to the third power minus 2 squared. Please, parentheses, do what's inside the parentheses. Well, there's only one thing inside the parentheses in this problem, 4 minus 2. 4 minus 2 is 2 to the third power minus 2 squared. Now, I didn't get rid of the parentheses here because that's not what that parentheses part indicates. We did what's inside the parentheses. Actually, I need the parentheses here or some kind of manner to indicate this multiplication because this says 3 times this. I could have put a dot there and got rid of the parentheses, but again, this does not necessarily mean get rid of parentheses. Please, excuse, exponents. Well, my next exponent is right here, 2 to the third. 2 times 2 times 2 gives us 8, and everything else carries down. I'm still on the excuse part, exponents. My next one is 2 squared. Notice how it's not affecting the minus out in front. Only affects what's to its immediate left. And 2 squared gives us 4. Please excuse my dear. Multiplication or division? Now, here's 3 times 8, which is 24, and everything else carries down. And then our last thing, Aunt Sally, addition and subtraction. We've got 24 minus 4, which gives us 20. And that's our answer. Let's see, 12 divided by 4 times 5 minus 7 times 2. Please, do it inside parentheses. There is no parentheses. Excuse, exponents. There is no exponents. My dear, multiplication or division is encounter either one from left to right. You do not want to go through and do the multiplication first. If you did 4 times 5 and got a 20, you'd end up with the wrong answer. You do either one as you encounter from left to right. My first multiplication or division is right here. 12 divided by 4, which gives us 3. And everything else carries down. My next multiplication division, going from left to right, is right here. 3 times 5, which gives us 15, minus 7 times 2. My next multiplication division is right here, 7 times 2, which is 14. And there's no more multiplication division. Aunt Sally, addition and subtraction. Only one thing left, 15 minus 14 gives us 1. And that shows you a couple of examples of the order of operations. And that's really all out of section 4.1. Now, section 4.1. I'll wake up here in a minute. I took a little nap before I got online. I stayed up to watch the meteor shower the other night, and I still haven't recovered. Stayed up and then went to sleep, and then woke up early to go see it. Saw nothing. So this is section R.2. And these I'm going to skip over. I don't think you'll have much trouble with those, reading the book or watching the video. And we'll go down to simplifying algebraic expressions. Now, of course, part of that is knowing a little bit about terms and so forth. Okay. Just generally, terms. You got a number times a variable, and I'll put an S on there. You can have more than one variable, or a variable times a variable. And again, I'll put an S on there to indicate you can have more than one. Examples of terms. Let me clear this off. Three would be a term. It's a number. 5x would be a term. It's a number times a variable. X squared would be a term. I don't see anything about exponents in here, but a variable times a variable. Well, remember what x squared means. That means x times x. So that's a variable times a variable. So these are all examples of terms. This is a little bit different definition than you'll run across in the book. I try to give a more of a simplistic definition than the textbook definition. Now we have something called like terms. And this is where you have the same variables to the same powers. Those would be like terms. Five x and 7x are like terms. Same variable to the same power. Numbers out in front, the coefficients can be different, but those have to be the same. 7x squared and 9x squared are like terms. They're both x to the second power. Now in terms of combining together, simplifying algebraic expressions, part of simplifying algebraic expressions is combining like terms. So, for example, if I had 7x squared plus 9x squared, Combining like terms means you add or subtract the numbers that are in front. 7 plus 9 is 16x squared. And that would be your answer. Sometimes it means getting rid of parentheses. For example, if I have 5x minus 2 plus 3x minus 8. Simplifying means get rid of parentheses also. Combine like terms means a lot of different things, but we're focusing on just a few items here. This first set of parentheses isn't doing anything, so I can just drop it. So I got 5x minus 2. The second set of parentheses isn't doing anything, so I can drop those. And I got 3x minus 8. Now you combine together like terms. 5x and 3x are like terms, same variable to the same power. So 5 plus 3 gives us 8x. Now we also want to combine numbers. I got negative 2 and negative 8, which gives us negative 10. And that's our answer. Now sometimes you have a minus in between them. You have to know how to handle that. For example, if I had something look like this. Now I said getting rid of parentheses is one part of simplifying. So this first set of parentheses didn't do anything, so I can drop it. So I got 8x squared minus 7x plus 1. Whenever you have a negative or a minus in front of your parentheses, this is going to flip the sign of everything inside. So the negative 3x squared becomes a positive 3x squared. The positive 2x becomes a negative 2x. And a negative 8 becomes a positive 8. So then we want to combine together like terms. Remember, like terms, same variable, the same power. These are both x to the second power. So 8 plus 3 is 11, so we got 11x squared. We got negative 7x and negative 2x. Negative 7, negative 2 gives us negative 9x. And we got 1 plus 8, which gives us 9. And that would be our answer. Okay, that's simplifying algebraic expressions. Now, section R.3, integer exponents in scientific notation. We're going to talk a little bit about some of the properties dealing with exponents. Some of these we'll do by discovery. For example, if I had x squared times x to the third. So we got x to a power times x to a power. Well, think what x squared means. X squared is x times x. That times carries down. X to the third, that's three x's. Once I write it out this way, I see I have five x's, so this becomes x to the fifth. The property says if you got x to a power times x to a power, you're going to add the exponents together. So we got x to the m power times x to the n power is equal to x to the m plus n power. For example, if I had x squared times x to the fifth. Well, since it's x to a power times x to a power, you add the exponents, x to the 2 plus 5, which gives us x to the 7th power. And that would be our answer. If you have a mix, if you have, for example, x squared y to the 3rd, and it's being multiplied times x to the 5th, y to the 4th, well, you multiply it together, the same variables. So x squared times x to the fifth would be together. The y to the third and the y to the fourth would be together. So then add the exponents. That'd give us x to the seventh. And that'd give us 3 plus 4 is 7. So we'd have y to the seventh. And that'd be your answer. Now we have another property. And again, you could discover it by by writing it out. X squared to the third power. Well, if I think about the third power, what's on the outside, x squared, the third power, that'd be x squared times x squared times x squared. I got three of them. But what x squared means is x times x. So I could rewrite each one of those x squareds as x times x. And we appear to have six x's. So this would be x to the six. Well, you can see that it looks like we're multiplying the exponents together. So that's our second property. If you have x to a power, or whatever variable you're dealing with, raised to another power, you're going to multiply the exponents. So you don't have to go all that work there. If you had x to the fifth to the third power, for example, since we've got x to a power raised to another power, you're going to multiply the exponents. So 5 times 3 gives us x to the 15th. And that'd be our answer. Now, another property is something to a zero power. Anything to the zero power is always equal to 1. Doesn't matter what you're dealing with. If you're wondering why 2 to the 4th is 16, 2 to the 3rd is 8, 2 squared is 4, 2 to the 1st is 2, going up. 2 times 2 is 4, 4 times 2 is 8, 8 times 2 is 16, 16 times 2 would give us 32. Going in reverse, 32 divided by 2 is 16, 16 divided by 2 is 8, 8 divided by 2 is 4, 4 divided by 2 is 2, 2 divided by 2 is 1. That's why anything to the zero power is always equal to 1 by definition. Don't try to think too much about it. It's like, what does that mean exactly? And try to mentally come up with an application for that. That's just one of those rules you just memorize. Now, if we have negative exponents. Negative exponents are pretty straightforward. We never want negative exponents. And how you get rid of a negative exponent is you move it opposite where it's at in the fraction. For example, this x to the negative 5, when I say move it opposite, we're going to move it up on top into the numerator. When you move anything opposite of where it's at in a fraction, the sign of the exponent changes. So the x to the negative 5 becomes x to the positive 5. And you always have a placeholder of 1. You never have blank for a fraction. So then that simply gives us x to the fifth. Now, on the other hand, if we start out with a negative exponent, like x to the negative 7, and I told you you move it opposite of where it's at in a fraction. Well, there isn't a fraction here. But remember, you can always create a fraction by putting it over 1. And now, we're going to move the part of the negative exponent opposite where it's at in a fraction. So I take the x to the negative 7 and move it down below. When you move anything opposite in the fraction, the sign of the exponent changes. So it goes from x to negative 7 to x to the positive 7. And we put a 1 of a placeholder up here. Okay. So exponent rules. Note, to get rid of a negative exponent, take the part with the negative exponent opposite of where it is at in the fraction and change the sign of the exponent to positive. Opposite of where it's at. Top to bottom, or bottom to top. That's what we just did over here. Here, we took this to the top, and it became x to the positive 5. Here, we took this to the bottom, and it became x to the positive 7. Now, that's how you handle negative exponents. Now, if you have a fraction to a negative power, for example, if you have x over y to the negative 3. Well, if you have a fraction to a negative power, what you do is you flip a fraction. Top goes to bottom, bottom goes to top. That's called reciprocal. Reciprocal means fraction flipped. And the sign of the exponent becomes positive. So we put that note down here. Note, if you have a fraction to a negative power, then flip the fraction, reciprocal, and change the sign of the power to positive. Now this should be called the distributive property of exponents. It's not. It should be called that, though. What it says is if everything inside the parentheses is either multiplication or division, and you're raising the parentheses to a power, then take everything inside to that power. I think it's one of the biggest missed pieces of exponents is they didn't give it a name. Let me clear this off. Okay, we got x squared, y, z to the third, and to the fifth power. Now notice, everything inside of the parentheses is either multiplication or division. We got x squared times y times z to the third, and you're raising the parentheses to a power. This says, if everything inside the parentheses is either multiplication or division, you're raising the parentheses to a power, then take everything inside of that power. So we're going to take the x squared to the fifth power, we'll take the y to the fifth power, and the z to the third to the fifth power. So we'll have x squared to the fifth, we'll have y to the fifth, and we'll have z to the third to the fifth. Now remember, when you're raising an exponent to another exponent, you multiply them together. 2 times 5 is 10, so we got x to the 10th, y to the fifth, and 3 times 5 gives us 15, so we'll have z to the 15th. And that would be our answer. We could have something look like this. X to the fifth, y squared over z to the eighth. All that raised to the third power. Notice how everything inside is either multiplication or division. X to the fifth times y squared divided by z to the eighth. When that occurs and you're raising the parentheses to a power, again, you can take everything inside to this power. Which means we're going to take x to the fifth to the third power, we'll take y squared to the third power, and we'll take z to the eighth to the third power. Now when you raise one exponent to another exponent, you multiply them together. 5 times 3 is 15, 2 times 3 is 6, and 8 times 3 is 24. And that would be our answer. Now this does not apply if you have something looks like this. If you got x plus y to the second power, you cannot take the x to the second power and the y to the second power because there's a plus in here. Everything inside your parentheses has to either be multiplication or division. We have to handle that differently, which we'll see later on. Now, we talked about the zero and negative exponents and different properties of exponents. Scientific notation I won't cover in the interest of time. Next part is more about radicals in rational exponents. This is formatting's a little bit bad here. I apologize for that. I can't see the... Should be right in front of me, but I'm not seeing it. Looking for superscript. There it is. Those should be superscript. Evaluate inf roots. We've already talked about that, so we won't go into much more depth on that. When just to make a connection between this and what we talked about earlier, though, inf roots are when you have a number here, like 5. So the fifth root of 32. 32 is 5 twos. 2, 4, 8, 16, 32. Remember, our index is 5, so we're looking for a set of 5. We've got 5 twos, so those 5 twos comes out as a single 2. Now, since there's nothing left inside a radical, radical disappears. And this would be your answer. That's about as much as I want to go in terms of the nth roots, but let's talk a little bit more about simplifying radicals, which is down here at the very bottom. It's connected with nth roots, but goes into more depth. If I had, and this is best shown by example, x to the 301 power. I showed you the example earlier where we'd write out how many x's we had. In an earlier example, I think we had 4 or 5 x's. I don't remember exactly. Here we have 301. Well, that'd be a lot of x's to write out. I'm looking for sets of 5 of them. Well, is there a shortcut for working with variables? Numbers, it's usually best just to do the prime factorization like we looked at. What you do is you do old-style division. So you take 301 divided by 5. And that's going to give us 60 with a remainder of 1. Now, if you're not sure, well, how do you get 60 with a remainder of 1? I truly believe there are no stupid questions, what people call stupid questions in mathematics. If there is something you do not understand, you can contact me. Say, I don't get how you get 60 with a remainder of 1. And I'll create a little YouTube video and send it back to you. If you try and understand, there are no stupid questions. I guarantee that. Well, 5 goes in 36 times. Doesn't go into 3 at all, so it goes in 36 times. 6 times 5 is 30. I subtract that. That gives me 0. I bring down this 1. 5 doesn't go into 1, so I put a 0 here. 0 times 5 is 0, and 1 minus 0 is 1. So this 60 goes right here, and what number is down here is your remainder. Now, how does that help us? Well, this is our, let me do this in different color. This is our power. This is our index. This 60 tells us how many come out, and this 1 tells us how many stay in. That tells us we're going to bring 60 x's out. So we're going to have x is 60th, and then the fifth root. And we got 1 x left inside, so I'll be x the first. So we'll have x is 60th, and then the fifth root of x. And now it'd be our answer. Now that's the shortcut. And that helps you when you got different variables, you have higher powers, and you have to think of it in those terms. You don't have to actually write it out, but that helps you figure out how many comes out. Let's take a look at another example of that. We've got square root of x to the 11th, y to the 5th, z to the 21st. Well, we take our power and divide by our index. Remember, your index is 2 because this is a square root. Your index is whatever number is in the slot, and if you don't have a number there, it's by default 2. So that's my power. This is my index. This is old-style division. 11 divided by 2 is 5, with a remainder of 1. So this is how many x's come out. This is how many x's stay in. Now if I look at my y's, I'll take 5, the power, divide by the index. 5 divided by 2 is 2, with a remainder of 1. This is how many y's come out. This is how many y's stay in. For our z's, we've got 21. 21 divided by 2 gives us 10, with a remainder of 1. So this is how many is going to come out, and this is how many is going to stay in. Okay, what do we say? We have 5 x's come out. We have 2 y's come out. We have 10 z's come out. And we're left with 1 x, 1 y, and 1 z inside. So we've got x, y, z. And that would be your answer. Now, in some problems, they have you worry about possibly putting an absolute value around a variable as comes out. If they do that in some of the problems, they'll very quickly drop that, and you won't have to do it in the rest of the course. But just as a guideline, if they don't tell you that all the variables represent positive numbers or something of that form, then let me give you a note on this. This is kind of the confusing part. Note on radicals and bringing variables out. If the index is even and the power of the variable coming out is odd, then put an absolute value. Assuming I could spell absolute value around that particular variable. If they do not tell you all the variables are positive. Okay, on radicals and bringing variables out. If the index is even, the power of the variables coming out is odd, then putting an absolute value around that particular particle, that particle variable, a particular, I used to be so good at English, variable. They do not tell you all the variables are positive. Well, this problem here, if they had not indicated that all the variables are positive, if your index is even, the index is even, this is a square root, this, 2 is our index. If index is even and the power of the variable coming out is odd, this is x to the fifth power, that's odd. That would tell us we put absolute value around x to the fifth. Now, y squared, that's an even power. Z to the tenth is an even power. The only one that has to have the absolute value around it is x to the fifth. I don't know if they really cover that very much in the ALEX system, but if they do, that's your guideline. It's confusing for a lot of different people. It doesn't apply to numbers. It just applies to variables when you're bringing them out. Okay, let me clear that off. And let's take a look at an example. We'll get the fifth power, or the fifth root, I should say, of x squared. Now this, that's in a radical form. We can rewrite this in fractional power form. This becomes x to the 2/5. So that's fractional power. More commonly referred to as a rational exponent. Rational means single fraction, so it's fractional power. Now how you go from radical form to our fractional power form is whatever power is inside here always goes up on top. Whatever your index is, always goes on the bottom. And that's the same going in reverse. Now, if we had a square root of x, for example, there is no exponent. But if I were to put a number here, it's a 2. Because remember, if you don't have a number here, by default it's 2. It's a square root. Now, there is no power here. But if I were to put 1, it's by default 1. So this becomes x to the 1/2. Again, whatever power is here goes on top. And whatever your index is goes on the bottom. Now, that's going that direction. If you had a problem like x to the 2/7, and instructions were to put it back into radical form, this would become the 7th root of x squared. Whatever number's on the bottom in your denominator, that always goes in your slot. That's your index. Whatever number's up on top is your power and goes right here. Now, sometimes you find it easier to get items out of radical form and into fractional power form so you can simplify it. They say simplify expressions with rational exponents. And what they mean by that, and there's a whole slew of different types of problems you have on this, but if I had, for example, let's see, x to the third over the third root of x to the 7th. And you want to simplify this. Well, there's really no division of radicals, so I'd rewrite each of these. This would be x to the 1/3 power, and this would be x to the, did I say 1/3 power? Let's try it again. X to the 3/2 power, and this would be x to the 7/3 power. Now, I wanted to talk about this particular property of exponents when we got here. If you have x to the 5th over x squared, well, you subtract a smaller exponent from a larger one. So 5 minus 2 gives us 3, and we'll have x to the 3rd where the larger exponent was. Larger exponent was on top, so we'll have an x to the 3rd here. And then we put a placeholder of 1 here. So again, if you have extra power over extra power, you subtract a smaller exponent from a larger one, and you have x to that power where a larger exponent was, and then the placeholder of 1 in the other location. Well, same idea holds true here, except these subtracted pretty easily. 3/2 minus 7/3, I don't know what that is, but if I get them to have a common denominator, which would be 6, if I multiply the bottom part here by 3, multiply the top part by 3, I get x to the 9/6 over, multiply the bottom part by 2 and top part by 2, I get 14/6. Now I got extra power over extra power, so I subtract the smaller exponent from the larger one. 14/6 minus 9/6 gives us 5/6. And we're going to have x to the 5/6 where our larger exponent was, which is on the bottom. So we'll have x to the 5/6 down here, and a placeholder of 1 up here. And that would be your answer. Now, that's a lot easier if you're using a graphing calculator, TI-3, TI-4, to subtract these, 3/2 minus 7/3. You may not know which one's the largest one by looking at it, but if you just try one, 3/2 minus 7/3, let's see what that gives us. 3 divided by 2 minus 7 divided by 3, enter. We get a negative. That means I got them in the wrong order. My larger one is actually 7/3. So if I do 7 divided by 3 minus 3/2 and press enter, and now we get that, you can do a math, enter, enter, and that'll change whatever decimal you have for fraction form. So that tells us 5/6. So we don't have to actually rewrite this in this manner unless you're doing it completely by hand. And then, of course, x to the 5/6 would go where our larger exponent was. Our larger exponent was 7/3, which was on the bottom. Now, when you're multiplying radicals together, for example, me do a number example. So square root of 2 times square root of 10. What you do is you multiply the numbers that's underneath. So you got 2 times 10. And then you simplify it. 10 is 2 times 5. We're looking for a pair of somethings. Here's a pair of 2's, so it's going to come out as a single 2. So we got 2 square root of 5. This works out because the indexes are the same. That's why you can multiply them together. If you have a problem where the indexes are different, like this right here, you cannot multiply those together in that manner. You have to rewrite them with fractional power form. So it'd have 2 to the 1/3 times 10 to the 1/5. Then, if we get a common denominator, which would be 15, here we multiply the bottom part by 5, so multiply the top part by 5. Here I multiply the bottom part by 3, so multiply the top part by 3. Then if we put this back into radical form, you see how they both have an index of 15. Which means I can now multiply them together. I really don't have time to go into a huge amount of examples dealing with all the different things you can do with rational exponents. I'm just showing you a couple examples, tying them together with some basic operations you probably saw in a previous class, showing how you can use them to work with radicals or fractional powers. Okay. Now they say simplify expressions of the form a to the 1 over n and a to the m over n. And we kind of alluded to that a little bit, but we haven't really shown it. I jumped down to simplifying expressions of the rational exponents. About to the bottom, so let me clear that off. Grab a drink while it's doing that. Okay. If I have 25 to the 1/2 power, we've seen that we put it into fractional power form in order to do simplification. But at the end, we usually want to put it back in a radical form if we think we can simplify it at the final. What do I mean by that? Well, 25 to the 1/2 power, I put that back in a radical form. Remember, whatever number's in your denominator here, that's your index, so put a 2 there. Whatever number's up at top is a 1. And a 2 is a square root, so that says a square root of 25. And 25 is 5 times 5. We're looking for a pair of somethings. Here's a pair of 5's, so they're going to come out as a single 5. And that would be your answer. On the other hand, if we got 8 to the 4/3 power, you get it down to that point and you're wondering, can I simplify it? Well, let's put it back in a radical form. Now we don't want to deal with large numbers though, so there's a little trick we can do when we have a number other than 1 up on top. And that's what this is referring to. A to the m over n. That means you don't have a 1 up in the numerator. What we can do before we do the process is put that number in the numerator on the outside of a set of parentheses. So we've got 8 to the 1/3 power to the 4th power. Now if we put this back into radical form, remember whatever your denominator is your index, whatever the number up on top here, your numerator, is your power. Cube root of 8. 8 is 2 times 2 times 2. Now, our index is 3, so we're looking for a set of 3 of something. Here's 3 twos, so those 3 twos are going to come out in front as a single two. So we've got 2 to the 4th, and 2 to the 4th gives us 16. So that allows us to simplify where we got expressions of the form a to the m over n power. I definitely haven't covered every operation you can do with radicals and rational exponents, but there's YouTube videos out there on those. Now, here we got polynomials and multiplication of radicals. We've already talked about adding, subtracting polynomials. Remember the like terms we talked about earlier and combining like terms? So let's skip down to the multiplying polynomials. And then we'll talk a little bit more about multiplying radicals and then the unique items that come with multiplying radicals. If you have a single item out in front of a parenthesis, single number in this case, it could be a single variable, it could be a single radical. It could, if you're going on a trig, it could be a single trig expression. But you got a single item out in front, which means there's no pluses or minuses between it. You just got like a 3. Then this is a distributive property. In earlier algebra classes, they may have told you it had to have a single number or a single term out in front. It's much more than that. It's just a single item out there. I know that sounds kind of vague. What we do that with that form is we take the number, in this case, the 3, and we multiply it times each term inside. Now, terms are separated by pluses and minuses. So we're going to take 3 times x squared. We'll take 3 times 2x. And we'll take 3 times negative 1. So that gives us 3x squared, 3 times 2 gives us 6x, 3 times negative 1 is negative 3. And that would be our answer. On the other hand, if we had something look like this, this is no longer the distributive property, because notice we got a minus in between the 3x and the 1. That means we got two terms out here. What we're going to do in this case is I like to think of this as a line method. We're going to take our first term here, this 3x, and we'll multiply it times each term in the other set of parentheses. And then we'll take our second term, this negative 1, and multiply it times each term in the second set of parentheses. So, if you're not red-green colorblind, this 3x, I follow the lines here. So I got 3x times 4x. I got 3x times 5, so I'm just following the lines. And then for the blue, I'm going to take negative 1 times 4x and negative 1 times 5. Now you may have learned this as FOIL. First, outer, inner, and last. So you multiply the first terms, you multiply the outer terms, the inner terms, and then the last terms. I like the line method because then it works no matter what. 3x times 4x gives us 12x squared. 3x times 5 is 15x. Negative 1 times 4x, negative 4x. Negative 1 times 5 is negative 5. So that gives us 12x squared, 15x minus 4x is 11x, minus 5. Always combine together like terms, no matter where you are in math. Now, the reason I like the line method is people don't always know when to use FOIL. If I had a problem look like this, for example. Some people might try to FOIL it. But FOIL only works if you got two terms and two terms, a binomial times a binomial. Here, we would have to take our first term here, multiply it times the first term over here, times the middle term, and times the last term. We would then take the 1 and multiply it times the first term over here, the second term, and the last term. So we would have 2x times 3x squared. We'd have 2x times negative 7x. We'd have 2x times 1. And then we'd have 1 times 3x squared. We'd have 1 times negative 7x. And we'd have 1 times 1. 2x times 3x squared. 2 times 3 is 6. X times x squared. Remember, you add the exponents. This is like the visible 1. 1 plus 2 is 3. Can't read my own writing there. What's that? 7, I guess? 2 times negative 7 is negative 14. X times x is x squared. 2x times 1 is 2x. 1 times 3x squared is 3x squared. 1 times negative 7x is negative 7x. And 1 times 1 is 1. So we're going to have 6x to the third. Always combine together like terms at any step. Here's an x squared, here's an x squared. So we'll add or subtract the numbers that are out in front. Negative 14 plus 3 gives us negative 11 x squared. Here we got 2x minus 7x, which is negative 5x, plus 1. And that would be our answer. So you can see the line method works no matter what. It doesn't matter how many terms or what to set up, it'll work. Let me clear those off. And they also talk about the special cases. So let's talk about those, and then we'll talk about radical expressions, then we'll get to the factoring, which is part I want to make sure I get covered, because that's part that I think is most important going on in this course. If I have x plus 2 squared, we talked earlier that what should be called a distributive property of exponents doesn't apply, because we have a plus here. We can't just square the x and square the 2. What we have to do is we have to rewrite this. X plus 2 squared means x plus 2 times x plus 2. And then if we follow our lines, we'll take this x times the 2. Then we'll take the 2, multiply it times the x, and multiply it times the 2. X times x is x squared. X times 2 is 2x. 2 times x is 2x. 2 times 2 is 4. Which gives us x squared plus 4x plus 4. So you can see it doesn't just give you x squared plus 4. Now that's our first special product. The other one is one that looks like this. These are called conjugates. Now, why they're conjugates is, see how this is 3x and this is 3x? This is 4 and this is 4, but the sign in the middle is different. Conjugates is when the first part and last parts are the same, but the sign in the middle is different. With conjugates, all you have to do is multiply your first parts together. So I'll take 3x times 3x, and your last parts. So I'll take negative 4 times 4. 3x times 3x gives us 9x squared minus 4 times 4 is 16. And that would be your answer. We're going to see more conjugates in a couple places in this course. Okay, now we talked about radicals before. Multi-radical expressions involving multiple terms. So, well, they're not exactly multiple terms, but multiple items. We talked about how if you had a square root of 2 times the square root of 3, well, here you'd have square root, and you multiply what's underneath the radicals. 2 times 3, now give us the square root of 6. Okay, well, that's pretty straightforward. But then the question becomes, how do you handle it when you got square root of x minus 2, times the square root of x plus 3, for example. Now, they call these multiplying radical expressions involving multiple terms. I just took these straight out of the competencies. These are not exactly terms. This is a radical expression. Well, again, we don't have to worry about the exact naming of it. We've already seen how to use the line method. You take the first item here, items being separated by pluses and minuses, and you multiply this first item times the first item over here and times the second item. Then we'll take our second item here, this negative 2, we'll multiply times each item over here. So, we're going to have square root of x times square root of x. We'll have square root of x times 3. We'll have negative 2 times the square root of x and negative 2 times 3. Now, square root of x times square root of x, since the index is the same, you multiply what's underneath the radicals and put them underneath the single radical. So square root of x times x plus 3 square root of x minus 2 square root of x minus 2 times 3 is 6. Remember with the square roots, I said we're looking for a pair of somethings. Here's a pair of x's, so this pair of x's is going to come out in front as a single x. And we'll assume that all of our variables are positive. Now, in mathematics, we talked about combining like terms, but you can combine like items. Just as long as they're exactly the same, what follows the number out in front, coefficient, just as long as these are exactly the same, you can combine them together by adding or subtracting the numbers in front. 3 minus 2 is 1, so we're going to have 1 square root of x minus 6, or x plus the square root of x minus 6. And that'd be your answer. Now let me clear that off. And let's take a look at a conjugate example. If we had, for example, square root of 3x minus 1 times the square root of 3x plus 1. These are conjugates. First part's the same, the last part's the same, the sign in the middle's different. Remember with conjugates, all we have to do is multiply our first parts together. So square root of 3x times square root of 3x, and the last parts, negative 1 times 1. Now when you're multiplying two radicals together, you multiply what's underneath them, put them underneath a single radical. So I'll put the numbers together. 3 times 3 and x times x. Minus 1 times 1 is 1. With square roots, we're looking for a pair of somethings. Here's a pair of 3's. They're going to come out as a single 3. Here's a pair of x's. They're going to come out as a single x. So we're going to have 3x minus 1 is our answer. Now this shows you, and I definitely haven't covered every item you'd run across, but this shows how you can extend the multiplying radical expressions to using the concepts we did with multiplying polynomials. Okay, let's go on to factoring now. Grab a drink here. And we'll clear this off. Factoring means to write as a product. I used to claim that you couldn't get through college algebra if you couldn't factor. I don't know if that's quite true, but it's kind of difficult to get through college algebra if you can't factor. So I'd recommend that you really get good at factoring. Prepare yourself for the course. Or for the rest of the course, I should say. So our first method is GCF. That stands for greatest common factor. Our second method we'll take a look at is grouping, I guess. This is where you have four or more terms. Third method we'll look at is dots, difference of two squares. And this is where you got two terms with a minus between them. It doesn't have to be terms. It just seems so vague when I say two somethings with a minus between them. But if you're going on to trig, you could have sine squared minus cosine squared, and that fits the definition of when would you use difference two squares. Our fourth method is PSD, and this is when it's of the form x squared plus bx plus c. This is a trinomial. Trinomial is when you have three terms. And we have our fifth method, which is key number, which is when you have the form ax squared plus bx plus c. We have the difference of two cubes. And this is when you got two terms with a minus between them. And we got the sum of two cubes. This is when you got two terms with a plus between them. Okay, so let's take a look at some examples of this. Say we got 7x minus 14. And the instructions on all of this is to factor. Our first method is GCF, greatest common factor. When you got numbers, you're looking for the largest number divides into both of these. We got 7 and 14, largest number divides into both those is 7. So factor out of 7. Now, factor means to divide out. Now, you might say, well, no, factor means to write as a product. Yes, but how you do that is you divide out. So 7 divided by 7 is 1, and the x remains, minus 14 divided by 7 is 2. So that's going to give us 7 times x minus 2. And that's our answer. If you have 7 looks like this, you're looking for the GCF. We got three terms. So looking at numbers, we got 4, 8, and 12. We're thinking the largest number divides into all those, which is 4. Now they also, all three terms have x's in common. Now you want to bring out the most x's you can, but you can't bring out three x's if this last term only has one x. So it's always the one with the smallest exponent. Now if I were to put an exponent here, this is like x to the first power. So we're going to bring out just a single x. Now remember, factor means to divide out. 4 divided by 4 is 1. Now here, imagine you have three x's sitting on your table. Somebody comes up and takes one of your x's away. Well, that means you have two x's left. So if you visualize that, you'll see that. Minus 8 divided by 4 is 2. We have two x's sitting up on the table. Somebody comes and takes one of our x's, which we're left with a single x. And then plus 12 divided by 4 is 3, and that x is gone. So our answer will be 4x times x squared minus 2x plus 3. Now if you have a, your first term is negative. I won't write this note down, but it applies no matter where you are in factoring. If your first term is negative, and you always want to bring out a negative no matter what. So I can bring out a negative. Now 4 and 12, I see the largest number divides in both those is 4. So my GCF, my greatest common factor, is going to be negative 4. So negative 4 divided by negative 4 is positive 1 with an x. Negative 12 divided by negative 4 is positive 3. So our answer is going to be negative 4 times x plus 3. Now let me clear those off. And that's GCF. Our next method is grouping. And there's no real particular order. GCF is always one you should look for first, but then after that, it depends upon what it looks like and which one you use. So this is not like a step-by-step approach. Let me see here. Okay, so let's say we got x squared plus 3x minus 7x minus 21. Start going through my list. GCF, greatest common factor. There isn't any. I got four terms. Some of them are divisible by 3. Some divisible by 7. Some have x's. Some don't. Or one doesn't. But all four terms have nothing in common. Start going through my list. Grouping is when you have four or more terms. What you do with grouping is you group first two terms together and you group last two terms together. Now, looking at only the first group, the first two terms, you ask yourself, what is the GCF of this first group? And I see they have an x in common. And that gives us x plus 3. And then looking at your second group, the last two terms, you ask yourself the same question. What's a GCF? Well, I see they're both divisible by 7, so I can bring a 7 out. And remember, if your first term is negative, you also bring out a negative. So bring out a negative 7. And that gives us x plus 3. Now, our goal is to get this set of parentheses the same as this set of parentheses. If you don't, then you can't use the grouping. You have to maybe use a different method, or maybe rearrange and try grouping. Now, since they both have an x plus 3 in common, I can factor that out in front. And to see what goes in your second set of parentheses here, you go up the previous steps and you cross out the x plus 3s, or whatever they have in common, and what isn't crossed out is what goes right here, which would be x minus 7. And that'd be our answer. Okay, let's take a look at 25x squared minus 9. GCF. 25, 9, don't have anything in common. Grouping is when you have four more terms. Well, this is two terms, so that doesn't fit. Dots. Difference two squares. Says two terms with a minus between them. Well, we got two terms with a minus between them. That fits. So we're going to try to rewrite this as something squared minus something else squared. Now what you do is you take a look at each individual piece and you ask yourself what times itself gives you that particular piece. For example, 25 is 5 times 5, x squared is x times x, and 9 is 3 times 3. So we were able to rewrite it as something squared minus something else squared. If you're able to do that, then that's when you can use difference two squares. Now I'm going to label what's inside the first set of parentheses as f for first, and I'll label what's in the last set of parentheses as l for last. And this is the formula for difference of two squares. It's f plus l times f minus l. So everywhere there's an f, I'll plug in 5x, and everywhere there's an l, I'll plug in 3. So I got 5x plus 3 times 5x minus 3. And that's our answer. Now the next method is PSD. Let me make up one. Okay, so we got x squared minus 2x minus 80. GCF. We've got three terms, they don't have anything in common. Grouping, it's four more terms. This is three terms. That doesn't fit. Dots is two terms. This is, again, three terms. Now, specifically with PSD, the form we're looking for is we're looking for x squared, x, and no x, and there's no number in front of our x squared, which works in this particular example. So this is going to be PSD. Now what we do with the PSD, we take the number at the end, the 80, and we ignore signs. So I'm going to work with positive 80. And we're going to come up with three columns. P column, an S column, and a D column. The P stands for product, the S stands for sum, and the D stands for difference. So we're going to write down all products give us 80. We got 1 times 80, 2 times 40, 4 times 20, 5 times something, let's see, 16, let's see, 6, no, 7, no, 8 times 10. If you're not very good at coming up with these products, you can use your calculator. 80 divided by 1 gives you 80, 80 divided by 2 gives you 40, 80 divided by 3 gives you decimals. If it gives you decimals, it doesn't go into it evenly. Now the S column, S for sum, it means we want to add these two numbers together. 1 plus 80 is 81, 2 plus 40 is 42, 4 plus 20 is 24, 5 plus 16 is 21, 8 plus 10 is 18. Difference column means we subtract the smaller from the larger. 80 minus 1 is 79, 40 minus 2 is 38, 20 minus 4 is 16, 16 minus 5 is 11, 10 minus 8 is 2. Now the number we're looking for is a number in our middle term, so we're looking for a 2. Well, 2 is right here. So we're going to use 8 and 10. So we're going to have x and then an 8, x and then a 10. Now the last thing we need to do is determine our signs. And we've got a note that helps us with that. It says the large number in the P column that we are using is always the same sign as the middle term. Now we're using 8 and 10, so larger of those two numbers is a 10. So a 10 is always going to be the same sign as the middle term. The middle term up here is a negative, so which means this 10 will be negative. Now if the number you circled is in the S column, then you can think of the S as S for same signs. If the number was circled in the difference column, you can think of the D as different signs. Now what I mean by that is if they're the same signs, that means they're both positive or both negative. If they're different signs, that means one's positive and one's negative. Now the number I circled is in the difference column, which means one's positive, one's negative. If the 10 is negative, then the 8 has to be positive, because they have to be different signs. And that would be our answer. Now, after you get more comfortable with working with the signs on this, you can use little tricks to help you figure out which column it should be in. A sign at the end will tell you which column it's going to be in. If it's a negative on the end, it'll always be in difference column. If there's a positive number at the end, it'll always be in sum column. So you can use tricks like that to help you. Let me show one more example of that. Okay, so we got x squared plus 14x plus 40. There's no GCF. Grouping is four more terms. This is three terms. Dots is two terms. This is three terms. PSD, x squared x, no number in front of our x squared. That fits. So with the PSD, we're going to take our number at the end, ignoring signs, so take the 40. We'll write down all products, give us 40. We got 1 times 40, 2 times 20, 4 times 10, 5 times 8. Add them. 1 plus 40 is 41, 2 plus 20 is 22, 4 plus 10 is 14, 5 plus 8 is 13. Subtract them, smaller from larger. 40 minus 1 is 39, 20 minus 2 is 18, 10 minus 4 is 6, 8 minus 5 is 3. Number we're looking for is 14, which is right here. So we're going to use 4 and 10. Now, remember our note. Larger number in the P column we're using, 4 and 10, so larger is 10, will always be the same sign as the middle term, which is positive. Now, the number we circled is in the S column, S for same signs. That means they'll both be positive, both negative. So if that's one's positive, this one has to be positive. And that's our answer. And let me clear this off, and then we'll look at the next type. Grab a drink at the same time. Okay, so let's take a look at 21x squared. You're not supposed to start with the answer, but that's an easy way for me to come up with examples to show you. Okay. So we've got this problem here. GCF. 21, 11, and 2, there is no GCF. Grouping is four more terms. This is three terms. Dots is two terms. This is three terms. PSD looks close, three terms, but there's a number in front of the x squared. You can't use PSD if there's a number in front of the x squared. Key number. The important part on the key number is we have x squared, x, no x, and there's a number in front of the x squared. So this one is actually key number. Now with key number, we take the number to beginning times the number at the end, ignoring signs. When I say number at the beginning, I'm talking about the number in front of the x squared. When I say the number at the end, I'm talking about the constant term at the end. And again, I'm ignoring signs. 21 times 2 is 42. We're still going to use a PSD table. We're going to use it a little bit different. We're going to write down all products of this 42. We got 1 times 42, 2 times 21, 3 times 14. 4, no, 5, no, 6 times 7, then add them. 1 plus 42 is 43, 23, 17, 13. Subtract them, smaller from larger. 42 minus 1 is 41, 21 minus 2 is 19, 14 minus 3 is 11, 7 minus 6 is 1. Now we're still looking for the number in the middle term, which is 11, which is right here, which means I'll use 3 and 14. Instead of just writing down our answer, though, we're going to rewrite the middle term using those two numbers. So we're going to rewrite the 11x using these two numbers. Now our larger, the note, all of our notes are assigned, so hold true. A larger number that we're using 3 and 14, so larger one is a 14, will always be the same sign as the middle term. Middle term is positive, so we're going to have a positive 14x. The number I circled is in my difference column. Remember D for different signs. One will be positive, one will be negative. So if the 14 is positive, then the 3 has to be negative. Then we're going to use factoring by grouping. My first group, they have a 7 and x in common, and that gives us 3x plus 2. Now, your second group has nothing in common, but if you have nothing in common, you can always bring out a 1. Even more than that, though, notice how the first term is negative, so I'll factor out a negative 1. And that gives us 3x plus 2. Now, remember with grouping, we're trying to get this parentheses the same as this parentheses, which they are. So I'll factor out a 3x plus 2. And again, to see what goes in your second set of parentheses, you can go up to your previous step, cross out what they have in common, the 3x plus 2s, and what isn't crossed out is what goes in the second set of parentheses, which is 7x minus 1. And that's our answer. Now our sixth method, difference 2 cubes. Let's take a look at this one. X to the third minus 8. I'll do this wrong to begin with. Let's see, GCF, there isn't any. Grouping, four more terms, no. Dots, two terms of the minus string. That fits. We got two terms of the minus string. So we try to rewrite this as something squared minus something else squared. But then you ask yourself, what time does self give you x a third? And it's like, that doesn't seem to make sense. And what time does self give you 8? Nothing, integer-wise. So it fails. Well, you notice down here, this says two terms of the minus trinum, and this one also says two terms of the minus trinum. So if the difference of two squares fails, you come down and you do difference of two cubes. Now, it's very similar, but instead of writing it that form, you write it this way. You write it as something third power minus something else to the third power. And you ask yourself, what times itself three times gives you each individual piece? For example, x to the third, that's x times x times x. The 8, that would be 2 times 2 times 2. So we were able to rewrite this as something third power minus something else third power. If you can do that, then you can use difference two cubes. I'm going to label what's inside the first set of parentheses as F for first. I'll label what's inside the last set of parentheses as L for last. This is the formula for the difference of two cubes. We've got F minus L times F squared plus FL plus L squared. Now, everywhere there's an F, you'll put in X, and everywhere there's an L, you'll put in 2. So we're going to have x minus 2, we'll have x squared plus x times 2 plus 2 squared, which gives us x minus 2 times x squared plus 2x plus 4. And that's our answer. Okay, let's say I have x to the third plus some 1. GCF, there isn't any. Groupings, four more terms. Nope. Dots is two terms of the minus between it. This is two terms of the plus between it. So no. PSD and key number are both three terms. That doesn't fit. Difference two cubes doesn't fit. But our last one, two terms with a plus between them. Sum of two cubes. Now that fits. So we're going to try to write this as something to the third power plus something else to the third power. You ask yourself what times itself three times gives us each individual piece. For the x to the third, that's x times x times x. And for the 1, that'd be 1 times 1 times 1. Now I'm going to label these. Label that as f what's in my first set of parentheses. I'll label that as l what's in my last set of parentheses. And this is just a formula. Assuming you can get it to fit that form, then you're going to plug it into f plus l times f squared minus fl plus l squared. Everywhere there's an F, you'll plug in X, and everywhere there's an L, you'll plug in 1. So we're going to have X plus 1 times X squared minus X times 1 plus 1 squared. Which gives us X plus 1 times X squared minus X plus 1. It always looks like you can factor those down further, but you can't. That last parentheses doesn't break down any further. Now, we didn't get through all the different topics, but you'll see under the instructor YouTube supplemental videos, I put a lot of different YouTube videos out here that I've created. These are full lectures. You probably don't want to watch every one of those. I mean, you can, but this goes over all the different topics in a lot more detail. For example, the factoring trinomials. Remember the PSD method and key number method? If you want to see more detail on this, just watch this video and you'll see a lot more examples. You get to practice a lot more with it. You might be tempted to dive in with the homework, but I would recommend if you're getting ready to do the homework, for example, on section R.6, that you go and watch these videos first. And I think you'll find the homework will come a lot easier. And you'll be better prepared. But then again, everybody learns different, so I can't say that's a hard and fast rule. That's the end of the recording, so I'm gonna stop the recording here, and I'll answer any questions you have.